Okay. So, thanks a lot to Alexander for the invitation to speak here. This panel mirrors a panel that we did on the, what was it called, the Commons and Cooperative Economy Conference in May. So my presentation is also going to follow closely what was said back then, in a different language, of course. I'm one of the few people here who's not an academic, not even an aspiring academic. I come from the social movements, and my involvement with the discourse of the commons is motivated by my involvement in the social movements. I want to somehow make a critique of the movement activity. And even though the discourse of the commons is not used by all movements that we call commons movements, and this can be a problem sometimes when we want to communicate with other movements and we want to find a common vocabulary, even though it is not widely used, I believe that it is one of the most potent analytical tools in order to understand the activity of the movements, of grassroots movements, and in order to demonstrate their revolutionary potential and explore the challenges that they face. So, I want to see what is the capacity of commons movements to affect wider social change that goes beyond the horizon of the crisis as we understand it. So, to that end, I would like to examine what is the relationship of the commons with the dominant institutions, the state and the market. To a great extent, the relationship with the state has been governed by the previous presentation. I'm going to focus more on the relationship with the market and the threats, the contradictions, and the opportunities that this relationship generates. Often the commons are presented as an anti-capitalist or post-capitalist force that can disrupt or overcome the dominant institutions of the state and the market. So, if we are to explore this anti-capitalist potential, we would have to start from some basic definitions of what the state is, what the capitalism is, what is power, what is the market. And most importantly, I would like to ask, is capitalism and the market, are capitalism and the market synonymous? Are we talking about the same thing? Or are there anti-capitalist or pre-capitalist markets? I'm not going to give a clear answer to this, because this could require a whole dissertation, I think. But I will start by giving three definitions of capitalism, three working definitions. One, capitalism is a system of exchange where the law of demand and supply in a free market defines what the prices are and, by extension, what is to be produced and how. I will not pay any attention to this definition. For two reasons. One, because it's the definition that the proponents of capitalism give to capitalism. Second, because I think that the idea of a free market is a fiction. There are no free markets, and there cannot be free markets. Indeed, Fernand Braudel, the French historian, he traces the origins of capitalism in the capacity of entrenched interests precisely to manipulate markets. He calls capitalism anti-market. This is just an indication of how the dominant narrative of the free market and capitalism is a fiction. Markets, for me at least, are always skewed in one way or another. The issue is who skews them and to what end. So it's a definition I'm not going to use. I'm going to use two other definitions. One is by Polanyi, who says that capitalism is an economic system where labor, land, and money, apart from objects, are commodities themselves. Of course, Polanyi is despised by many radical thinkers, especially Marxists, because his theory lends itself to social democratic solutions and interpretations. However, I don't think that Polanyi necessarily can be read from a social democratic perspective. There are other readings that can be made. And of course, the third definition is that of Marx, where capitalism is a system where commodities are produced and capital is accumulated through the process of appropriation of surplus value, that is, through the exploitation of labor and consequently of the working class. As social change, if we are giving definitions here, let us define social change. We define the transformation of social practices and institutions towards increased equality and freedom. Consequently, the transformation of subjects, both collective and individual, towards the same direction. The issue of subjectivation and identity is very important for me. We have had at least two interesting presentations, two interesting contributions in this workshop on this issue of subjectivation and identity, one by Alexandros just before when he's talking about collective identity, shared collective identities under a common hegemonic bottom-up project, and the other one was by Angelos Varvaroussis, when he described how crisis and liminality breaks down traditional identities and fosters the emergence of militant subjects. I will concentrate on another important issue, as I told you, which is the relationship between commons and capital. So the commons are a very contested concept. There are different schools of thought have developed around the concept of the commons, and each of them uses different concepts that facilitate or preclude different kinds of political practices oriented to social change. The first approach, which should not be explained in detail, we are familiar with it, is the approach, institutionalist approach of Eleanor Ostrom. Of course, Ostrom is particularly interested in natural resources and especially how their collective self-management can avoid what is notoriously called the tragedy of the commons. Of course, there are enormous political, there's enormous political significance in Ostrom's argument, since she offers arguments in favor of collective coexistence and in favor of self-management at a time, the second half of the 20th century, when methodological individualism in the context of neoliberalism was on the rise. However, Ostrom, with her insistence on an effective management, fails to outline a new subject. She just seems to argue that the individual economic pursuits of the profit-maximizing individual of the homo economicus can be best served by collective self-management. Most of Ostrom's examples relate to collective resource management, like irrigation, fisheries, forestry, geared towards the production of goods, of commodities to be sold in the market. So, in this definition, collective self-management appears to be like a collateral to market participation, where everyone aims to maximize their individual benefit. Ostrom perceives the commons as closed systems and seeks to find the endogenous causes of their success or their failure, and thus fails to provide a meaningful critique of the institutions within which the commons emerge and develop, the state and the market. Her vision, unfortunately, can lend itself to the utilization of the commons by capitalism for its own ends. We have seen many speakers have mentioned the idea of the third sector, the idea of the big society. The commons are approached as welfare mechanisms that can alleviate the crisis. The state provides institutional support to the commons. In return, the commons mitigate the most acute social repercussions of capitalism, absorbing the shocks of the system without providing an underlying criticism of the causes of this crisis. All these are the arguments of another approach that I'm going to examine, the approach of the autonomist Marxists. In this current phase of development, capitalism needs the externalization of the cost of social production. So it needs to promote some kind of domesticated commons, benign commons, that's not threatening to the dominant order, that can alleviate capitalism's crisis of reproduction and ensure social peace. So the commons under this conception are a safety net. A characteristic example are the policies of the governing party of Syriza in Greece. On the one hand, the commons are the cornerstone of its parallel program of social salvation. The commons, the solidarity structures, the alternative economies. On the other hand, the policies of dispossession, of neoliberal restructuring, go on unperturbed. Another Marxist critique focuses on the fact that to the extent that commoning projects involve commodity production, the capitalist law of value permeates, penetrates its activity and imposes its logic. So a radical cooperative, for example, can have an horizontal internal organization and democracy in its interior, but its participation in the market operates as an external boss who will define what is going to be produced, how it's going to be produced, at what rate, what intensity of labor, what the remuneration of the worker is going to be. This often leads to phenomena of self-exploitation. This is a very important and a useful observation. To navigate the above criticisms and to give some context, some radical context, content to the commons, autonomist commons thinkers have tried to differentiate between anti-capitalist commons on the one hand and distorted or commodity-producing commons on the other hand. In their perception, the commons are always embedded in communities of struggle. They are antagonistic to the permanent processes of enclosure. So, it's not about the common goods as resources. It's about commoning as a process that simultaneously produces subjects, produces collectives that can intervene and antagonize the dominant political and economic system. So the commons are embryonic forms of a future liberated society. However, an excessively close reading of Marx's idea about the commodity fetishism, about the law of value permeating all aspects of social life, leads some of the people who are radical Marxists to conclude that the only non-capitalist relationships are the ones that emphasize use value and reject exchange value. If we take this idea to its logical conclusion, all solidarity economy endeavors are distorted commons because they involve commodity production. They do nothing else but capitalize resources, skills, social relationships for the purpose of accumulation, even if we're talking about an alternative form of accumulation. This idea that solidarity economy is the Trojan horse of capitalism is quite widespread in Greece among left and libertarian movements. So, under this prism, from this prism, we should ask the question, can societies as complex as the one that we live in reproduce themselves without some kind of impersonal system of exchange? Or is the only anti-capitalist practice to have very small, tight-knit communities that freely exchange goods between them without any kind of exchange? I think that this simplistic view that all exchange is inherently capitalist reproduces the economicism of classical Marxism in this kind of Marxism that deems itself radical and wants to escape from the straitjacket of classical Marxism. So they argue that the labor-capital contradiction is the dominant contradiction within the capitalist system, and they reduce all the other contradictions to this central one. What other contradictions are there? For example, uneven power relations, uneven geographic development, private property of the means of production, private appropriation of the fruits of our own labor, gendered and racial divisions of labor, disparities of wealth, alienation, as well as the economy's impact on our environment. So the commons endeavors have a great capacity to alleviate and to address and remedy all these contradictions. And by focusing just on the labor-capital contradiction, we underestimate the capacity of the commons to do so. So this is a kind of promotion of what Gibson Graham calls capital law-centric thought. They underestimate the capacity of values to confront value. This is because, as in the classical Marxism, the values are nothing but a component of the superstructure. They are a reflection of the material conditions. While for most component endeavors, values are a structural component of reality, not just an element of the superstructure. So there are grounds for the separation between capitalist commons and anti-capitalist commons. But in societies where the market is the predominant mechanism of social reproduction, all commons and all capital, on the other hand, are always in hybrid or transitional forms. So what we need is a particular arrangement between the two, a particular structural coupling in the terms of Massimo De Angelis, who is a bright exception within the autonomist Marxist thought. A structural coupling that allows the coexistence, even in an antagonistic relationship, of these two different systems of value creation, because that's the only way that the commons can take root in societies that are governed by capital. Of course, the requirements of the market are prone to infect commons endeavors with their own logic and their own considerations: profitability, cost efficiency, competitiveness, and so on. However, we should not overlook the fact that the infection can be bidirectional. Wherever there is a front line between these two competing, antagonistic systems of value creation, potentially the commons can also challenge the capitalist systems of value creation, the local rules, the capitalist ways of to measure and give value to social action. So it is necessary not just to delimit, to define what are the anti-capitalist and the capitalist commons, but to create these kind of front lines within all the existing fields of dispute on the commons. We cannot think of the commons as islands of freedom which should be or can be untouched by capital, and that can just bring about social change just by enlarging them or just by multiplying them. We need to confront the dominant institutions, and to do so, we have to get in contact with them. Our relationship with the capitalist commodity is very contradictory. On the one hand, the capitalist commodity represents our chains, represents our source of alienation from our world around us. And the Marxist critique of the fetishism of the commodity is very valid in this respect. It represents our source of dehumanization. On the other hand, we're dependent on the commodity for our reproduction. Even our commoning would be impossible without all the material substrate provided by capitalist commodities. So, is there a way for the commons to coexist with the commodities without being absorbed by the capitalist logic? What is the form of this structural coupling between commons and capital if it is to be transformative towards a more liberatory and emancipatory direction? So, given that we cannot speak about commons in pure form, there are always combinations of the two, there are always hybrid forms, the question we should ask in each case that we examine is, who is using whom for its reproduction? Is capital using the commons, or are the commons using capital? So let's think of some examples where the commons can use the commodity. A social center, for example, that sells drinks. Okay, we have the production of commodities and money exchange, but the proceeds go towards maintaining the community, expanding the activities of the community that manages the social center, not towards the accumulation of capital. For example, we have the example of socially supported agriculture, where a community of consumers guarantees the income of farmers. in exchange for agricultural products. There we have, of course, exchange of some sort. At the same time, you have a community of farmers and consumers who collectively decide on what to produce, what the quantity and the quality of goods will be. Some forms of fair trade, of course, there are great criticisms towards fair trade, but some forms of fair trade where the products' prices and the products' quality are not decided by the impersonal laws of supply and demand. They are determined by the perceptions of both consumers and producers of what solidarity means, what fairness means, what sustainability means. We should qualify all this. Of course, there are great criticisms, I repeat. An occupied factory, for example, which through occupation of the grounds provides to the whole of society an access to the means of production, a say to, as to what will be produced and how, but at the same time tries to find alternative product distribution networks to market its products. An alternative currency network, for example, where a community decides to establish different product exchange rules with a kind of money that retains its function as a unit of measure of value, not as a means of capital accumulation. And to take an example of immaterial production that has been mentioned already, a firm, a business, software developer business, for example, that uses its revenue to finance the production of free software, which is a common. And of course, the practice of transvestment, about which we have talked about. All these attempts, of course, are incomplete. They're precarious. And always there is a danger of capital managing to overturn them and co-opt them. But they are attempts to deal, to address the relentless law of value of the capitalist market and replace it with new systems of valuing human action that derive from the world of the commons. So, we're talking about values against value. These kind of value struggles, I think, are at the core of modern social struggles. Of course, this is not to say that the importance of the gift of moneyless exchange, of free access to resources, of reciprocity, which lie at the heart of the life of the commons, are not important. And I'm not arguing that all of the above, all of these efforts to confront the market, are sufficient. They're necessary, but not sufficient. We should also concentrate on resisting the processes of resistance against enclosures, defend our collective conquests, our collective rights, which have been gained through historical processes of struggle. What I do argue is that we should be cautious of all these common theories, both of these that approach, that consider the commons as islands of freedom that are untouched by the dominant institutions, of the approaches that treat the commons as collective systems of resource management, but also of those approaches that argue that the commons are a new mode of production in the making that teleologically, deterministically is going to substitute the capitalist mode of production. On the contrary, the commons are always embedded in antagonistic social movements, in communities of struggle. They are promoted through practices that seek to create cracks on the dominant institutions, but also communities that have a political vocation that aim to diffuse their discourse among society, to create new common identities, to awaken militant subjectivities, and to form a common political project. And here I have to agree with the previous presentation by Alexandros to a great extent. In my opinion also, it's not the state that we're aiming for, but the local, the municipal level, as a level par excellence, the level of proximity of commons building, of community building. So the struggle between commons and capital will never end. The capital permanently tries to adapt the attempts of the commoners to subvert it. It appropriates and utilizes our structures in order to further its own ends. But there is no zero-sum game between resistance on the one hand and co-optation or appropriation on the other hand. There's always an excess produced. There's always something left behind. And this something is going to form the substrate on which new commons endeavors are going to emerge and flourish. Thank you.